Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Hey, welcome. Are you guys excited to be here tonight on 26-year anniversary? Oh man, it is so cool. In a little bit, we have something special, and I'm just going to just tell you right now, as you walked in, there was a sign on the door that you probably have never read, but by law we have to put it there, that says you may or may not be filmed or photographed, and your likeness may, just to let you know, in a little while there's going to be something that goes on and the lights are going to go down, and I'm going to take a picture of you, just so you know, okay? So that's why those things are there. You're like, Pastor Luke, I don't want, it's all right, the lights will be dark, hold your glow stick in front of your face, all right? There you go. Well, I'll tell you what, God is so good. It's just such an honor to be here tonight. I'm excited for what we've got going on right afterwards. We're going to have a good time. We're going to celebrate. You know what we're going to do? We're going to enjoy each other's company. I think that's the best part of any party, right? Just to be the life of the party. And I tell you what, you and I together as the church, we are the life of the party. Hey, listen, before we get into the festivities tonight, we want to keep the service short. I know you guys are thinking about cotton candy. I know you're thinking about popcorn. So we want to make sure to get you out there so you can enjoy that. But before we do that, one of the things that we always do is we're a word-based church. We want to talk about the Word of God. And tonight on our birthday, I want to just talk about a couple special scriptures here at the church. So I'm going to go before the Lord in prayer. You can just remain seated. You're already there. We're already ready to go. But let me go before the Lord in prayer. Why don't you just bow your heads and join with me as we prepare our hearts to receive from the Lord. Father, we come before you. And Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that you've given to us to be here tonight. Lord, we thank you that we have the privilege to celebrate 26 years of ministry here at the Rock Church World Outreach Center. Truly, this isn't a building's birthday. This isn't just a nonprofit organization's 26th anniversary of business. This is the church. Every one of us in this room, this is our birthday, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to gather together as family and to celebrate. Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit is in the midst of us tonight. Lord, overshadow us, empower us, equip us to go and to be your church, to reflect your kingdom, to reflect your glory for a lost and dying world, like those glow sticks we're holding in our hands. Lord, that we might shine the light of the goodness of God to a lost and dying world. Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for this house. Father, we thank you for our pastors, Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah. Lord, we thank you that if it wasn't for faithful stewards like Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah, Lord, we wouldn't be here today. And Lord, we are so grateful to have leadership like that. And Lord, we ask that you would bless them, bless the staff here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. Lord, I ask that you would bless each and every person tonight as we are here celebrating the church birthday, Lord. And to you be the praise, to you be the glory, to you be the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Well, hey, listen, let me give you a little bit of a rundown of just some things. If you're new to the place, if you're just visiting, or this is your first time at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, say, man, you guys are an awful noisy bunch. Hey, this is the Rock, all right? Even though I say this is a different service, we're still a noisy bunch. And you know what? We believe that Jesus said that if we don't praise him, that the rocks will cry out. We're not going to ever let a rock do our job. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that the angels are glorify God so much that the very foundations of heaven shake. So you know what? Y'all got to get used to a little bit of noise in the house, because where we're headed is even more noisy. So, but with that, this is a special service. It's a special event. We're going to have a good time. And one of the things that we're doing is we're celebrating the 1 year anniversary of our Freedom for Our Future Capital Stewardship Program. All right. And normally, in a church, especially at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, you may not be accustomed to seeing a church receive or have the opportunity to have more than one offering. Some of you say, well, I've been in many churches where that happens. And at the Rock Church, it's very uncommon. More than one altar call, absolutely, but more than one offering is not very common. But tonight's a special night. We're celebrating. We've prepared, and we've been teaching about and encouraging to prepare a special gift towards the house. And so we're going to receive an offering at the end of the service. And before we do, I want to make sure that the ushers give you the time to think about that, if you have that, to prepare. So the ushers are going to stand to their feet. They have a little yellow envelope. The ushers, if you guys got that, ushers, you can go ahead and stand that. They're going to just pass out this yellow envelope. And what this yellow envelope is this is just a seed envelope. We believe that it's planting a seed into the ground. And what this is this is just giving towards freedom for our future. Maybe you haven't yet made a pledge or gotten involved. We have pledge cards made out for you, but you know, we didn't plan that out real well. So if you want to make a pledge or you want to get involved, you can write that out here on the envelope, and we'll pay attention to that. We'll put that in on the books as well. And we just want to give you the opportunity to get involved. So the ushers are passing those down. Just hold on to it. We're not pressuring. Listen, you don't have to. We're not forcing. But we just want to give you the opportunity to get involved. So the ushers are going to do that. As we do, we're going to get into the Word of the Lord tonight. Now, I don't even have a title for tonight's message. The Word of God is so rich and alive that I couldn't even name it, I'll tell you what. So we'll call it Freedom for Our Future. How about that? Or we'll call it Birthday Celebration. Or we'll call it Freedom for Our Future, Birthday Celebration. Okay, all right. Tonight, what I wanted to do is, simply put, I just wanted to talk a little bit about us. Since it's our birthday, I wanted to talk about us. You and I. Who are we? What are we? Why are we here? What are we doing? And what I want to do in that message, just in our birthday, is to kind of take you and I, let's go on a little journey of just some scriptures. And basically, I'm going to take you to two main passages, or two main scriptures that are staples, that are really the heartbeat of the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, and what we believe and what we have stood on for 26 years. And I want to just share that with you. As we're celebrating 1 year of Freedom for Our Future, when we look at these verses, when we look at what Jesus and when we look at the prophets say about serving God and our sacrifice to God, it really paints a picture of why it's so important for you and I to do something about what we hold dear, and that is our church. So if you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Matthew. We're going to look at Matthew, in Matthew the 25th chapter. Now, I remember one of the cool things was hearing some of those statistics. I was the first banker. I totally had no clue. All right, right on, man. Pastor Steve was like, yeah, don't you remember? I'm like, no, but okay, cool. I do remember. I did win the Bible battles growing up, so see, I mean, I was rolling in the rock dollars, and I had access to the printer as well, so, no, I'm just kidding, But one of the things I do remember is in our youth room, it was like a multi-purpose room, in our youth room, junior high youth room, we had this big mural painted, and it was this passage of Scripture, and it was just a staple, it was just a foundational verse for what we at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center believe and why we're here. You could say it's a mission statement, and this is for you and I tonight. This is our mission statement of what God has in store for us. So let's just look at who we are, what we do, and why do we do it? You know, they always say that there's those big who, what, where, when, why. Well, we're here tonight, so we know when, where. We're at San Bernardino, so we'll look at who, what, why. So Matthew, the 25th chapter. Matthew, in the 25th chapter, Jesus is speaking. And I love the words of Jesus here. He paints such a picture of the kingdom of God. And he paints a picture, and he does so in such a way that he personalizes it. And this is where the impact really comes. In Matthew, the 25th chapter, starting in verse number 31. Matthew, the 25th chapter, verse number 31, it says, "And when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations," verse number 32, "all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another. As a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats, he will set the sheep on his right and the goats on his left." I love how it says, "All the nations of the earth shall be gathered." It means every person, every man, woman, and child, every person on this earth will be gathered together, will be reconciled to the kingdom of God, will be brought. God is bringing all things, and it says he will bring them, and he will separate the sheep from the goats. Now look what it goes on, and it says, in verse number 34, "And then the king," I love that, "the king," speaking of God, "the king will say to those on his right hand, the sheep, 'Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world.'" What an amazing statement. What an amazing testimony for you and I to understand that when we are in the kingdom of God, when we are in the body of Christ, we have an inheritance. Not just a fiscal inheritance, not a financial inheritance. That's what we talk about. For the past month, we've been discussing the subject of finances. But you know, the reality is, we haven't ever even talked about finances. What we have been talking about is the heart. Because what we're talking about is allying our hearts with God to look at our inheritance, which is the kingdom of God, which was set before the foundation of the world. And now look what Jesus says. The king, he says, the picture, the king says, "For I," you see that word, it says I, look to your neighbor and say I. I. So here, imagine, this is God speaking to his people as a painted picture, and God speaking to his people says, "I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. The creator of the universe, the king of kings, the Alpha and the Omega, the one who is the earth is his footstool, is speaking to his people. And he says all the things. Verse number 37 goes on and he says, I was naked, you clothed me. I was sick, you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Now I know if you've never read this passage of scripture before, you're thinking exactly what the verses following say. Verse number 37 says, then the righteous will answer and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty and give you drink? Verse number 38, when did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Verse number 39, when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? Imagine this, the impact of the story that Jesus is saying. He's saying, you came and you visited me. You fed me. You clothed me. You took care of me. When I wasn't feeling good, you picked me up and you wiped the dust off and you held me close. And we looked at Jesus. We looked to the King and we say, when on earth, when in time, when in the span of creation did we ever do this to you, God? And Jesus goes on in verse number 40. And he says, and the King will answer and say, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to the one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Jesus says, you did this to the lowest of person, you did this to me. When you did this to the least of the people, not the cool, not the socially acceptable, not the smart, not the educated, not the talented, not the gifted, not the people that are well off in life, not the beautiful, but he says, when you did this to the least of these, my brethren, you did this to me. The heartbeat of the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. Many of you know this because, like you and I together, hey, I was never the cool guy in school. I was always the one that just never fit in. You say, Pastor Luke, what the heck are you talking about? Well, listen, I'm telling you the truth. This is not a church. Some of you are cool and we love you. Oh my goodness, you make us so cool. But this is a church from the very beginning that believed in this. We asked, as Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah prayed, they could have prayed for anywhere. They could have prayed for Orange County. They could have prayed for Lake Forest. They could have prayed for the outskirts of San Diego or for Malibu. They could have prayed for Santa Barbara, Ventura. They could have gone to the wealthy cities. But as they sat there on the rim of the world, as Pastor Deborah's talked about on her jacuzzi, they prayed for San Bernardino. Yeah. Why? No, I'm just kidding. Because this verse, when you did this to the least of these, my brethren. You know, the news reports have been out for years. In March, I read a thing from the NPR that somebody had forwarded saying that San Bernardino is a cesspool, that people are moving out of prosperous communities because they can no longer afford housing, and they're moving into San Bernardino where there is no jobs, where there is no opportunity, where there is nothing, and they're just existing on government existence. This is a land, this is a city, this valley. As you see, as the wind blows, we get all of the smog from the wonderful old LA and Orange County. Your skies are so clear because we got your smog. Jesus says, if you did this to the least of my brethren. So when this church was started at the Econo Lodge, Pastor Jim prayed, God, give me every pimp, every prostitute, every drug addict, every person with missing teeth, every uneducated person, everybody who's broken in their lives. God, bring them here to this church, because ultimately, church, you and I are all broken jars of clay. But God says, I will take the broken jar of clay and I will build you up and I will use you for a vessel of honor in my house. And so Jesus says, when you do this to the least, you do this to me. The heartbeat of the Rock Church and World Outreach Center has always been people. Has always been people. In the grand scheme of things, what's $13 million on a mortgage? People say, "What? How could you even finance that much money? Why? Like Pastor Jim said, why wouldn't God just pay it off? Because what is God more interested in? Interest payments, mortgage balances, or souls? hungry mouths fed, babies with diapers, clean diapers and wipes, beans and rice for those that needed it, for altar calls in the streets, for hygiene products under the bridge, for missions around the world. Jesus said, when you do this to the least, you do this to me. Church, the mission statement has and always will be at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center to love people to life. To love people to life. I love that song that we sang. A common theme in my own heart that's been resonating is we had this expo called Good Works. Good works. We believe that when we do good works that people see God, but we also believe that when you do good, it works. But God spoke to my heart and he says, good works is good, but let's not settle church for good. Let me tell you something. 20,000 members at the Rock Church World Outreach Center, that's pretty good. 500,000 people every year fed, that's pretty good. 145 nations around the world, that's pretty good. But I love how that song we sang today, for greater things are yet to come. Come on, let's get ready to go beyond good and let's start passing into the greater things that are yet to come. Look what it says in Isaiah, the 58th chapter. Isaiah, the 58th chapter. Talking about sacrifice. This is the prophet, a prophet speaking to the people, and they're saying, God, we've fasted. God, we've sacrificed. God, we've cried out to you, but you don't hear our cries. And God begins to speak back to the prophet. He says, you're doing the sacrifice. You're giving how you want it to be, how you think it should be. You're acting, and though you think that this is a gift to me, but it's really your own. And he begins to say, this is what your sacrifice should look like. Isaiah, the 58th chapter. It is a fast that I have chosen, God says. A day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down, this is verse number 5, bow down his head like a bulrush, to spread out sackcloth and ashes? Would you call this a fast? To butt your head, to get ready to charge? In verse number 6, it says, this is not the fast I have chosen. Is this not the fast I have chosen? Excuse me, listen to this. To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and that you bring your house to the poor who are cast out? When you see the naked, that you cover him, and that you do not hide yourself from your own flesh? And then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. God's going to watch your back. He says, I want you to loose the bonds of wickedness. I want you to feed the hungry. I want you to pray for the oppressed, to heal the sick, to pray and cry out to God with what you have been given in your hands. And when you do, that is when God's blessing comes out. But that's not even the cool part. That's not even the part I really wanted to focus on. Look at this. Verse number 9. Then you shall call the Lord God, and he will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, here I am. If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger, the speaking the wickedness, if you extend your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall dawn in the darkness, and your darkness, your dark times, shall be as the noonday. Look what it says in verse number 11. The Lord, listen, I don't know about you, but this is for me in my own life. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought. You shall shall strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden, a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Church, the mission statement of the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, which means your mission statement, which means my mission statement, is people, souls, to feed those who are in need, to clothe those who are naked, to take care of those who could not take care of themselves, to show them the love of God. And the Bible says that God will begin to bless you. You will be like a well-watered garden, a spring that does not run dry. My wife and I, we just got back from camping in Yosemite for a couple of days. One of the tallest waterfall, Yosemite Falls in North America, fourth tallest waterfall in the world is in Yosemite. But you know what's crazy about it? It dries up in the summer. It dries up. It's a seasonal water flow. But we went to a waterfall. We hiked to a waterfall where it's a rainforest at the waterfall. In the same park on the other side of the valley is a waterfall called Nevada and Vernal Falls that runs as a torrent, as a raging torrent year round. Whether it's drought or whether it's season of plenty, this river will not dry up. And God says, you won't be like the waterfall on one side of the cliff cascading down, that in the summer when the heat hits, when everything dries up, when the resources are gone, have nothing left to give, you will be like the water on the other side of the valley that rages on, that rushes on, that moves those immovable rocks, that carves out canyons, that moves mountains in your life. God says that will be you and I. Those from among you, church, from among you. Look to your neighbor and say, among you. Doesn't mean LA. That doesn't, okay, LA's cool, great. That doesn't mean Orange County. That doesn't mean San Diego. That doesn't mean Washington, D.C. That doesn't mean Sacramento. Among you means San Bernardino. Means Redlands, Yucaipa, Highland, Colton, Rialto, Riverside, Muskoy, High Desert, Ontario, Rancho, wherever it might be. Those who are among you shall build the old waste places. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in. Which means, church, government is not going to fix the Inland Empire. Jesus is going to fix the Inland Empire. Jesus is going to fix our families, our cities, our homes, our dwelling places. Jesus is the solution. So why is this important for you and I? Because it's time. It's time for you and I to look at each other and to say, what is in our hands? What can we do? You might say, it's insignificant. It's drop in the bucket. It's nothing. Let me tell you something. Nothing to God is everything when it comes from your heart. Just like the woman that we read about this morning with just a jar of oil. She had nothing in her house. Oh, but a jar of oil. But God used that jar to succeed her, to provide for her. And I'll tell you what, this church has always existed on faith and fumes. And we are not in freedom for our future to get out of living in faith in fumes. Simply put, the faith in fumes that the Rock Church and World Outreach Center lives on right now will be a different faith in fumes in 3 years, because now we will live on faith in fumes for the world. Now we will live on faith in fumes for outreach. Now we will live on faith in fumes for affecting the Inland Empire. No longer worrying about mortgages. No longer worrying about making budget for employees so that the people that work here can feed their families. That's not what we're worried about. Now we're worried about getting out into the world and doing something for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can settle for good, or we can go to great. We can go to great. I want to just take you to one last scripture. One last scripture today. Luke, the 10th chapter, verse number 1. Luke, the 10th chapter, verse number 1. The 70 disciples are coming back from Jesus after being sent out, reporting all sorts of different things. And Jesus says, in these things the Lord appointed 70 others also, and sent them two by two before his face into every city. He sent people out, listen to this, before his face into every city and place where he himself was about to go. Listen, look at that. This is a last minute add-on, otherwise I would have highlighted that. Where he himself was about to go. He sent messengers ahead of him. Jesus sent messengers ahead of him. But then look what he says. Number two. Oh, thanks guys. Number two. Verse number two. All right, there you go. Then he says to them, the harvest is truly great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. God is desiring us, each and every one of us, in each and every one of our capacities, no matter how old or how young. We got the families in here today. Hey, 10-year-olds can witness for Jesus Christ to their schools. But Jesus says, pray that the Lord would send harvest or laborers out into the harvest. You and I are the laborers. We are the vessels in which God's will be performed here in the Inland Empire. And it is time for you and I to get our reaping in hand, to get our tools, to put our gardening gloves on, because it's harvest season here in the Inland Empire. And now the harvest is plentiful. And now I look out about this auditorium and I look at about the 8,000 adults that attend on a weekend and I say, the harvest is plentiful and we've got lots of laborers. Now it's time that we get to work. Did you guys get something out of that tonight? Praise God. God is so good. Listen quickly, a couple of things before we conclude. I want to just give you the opportunity in just a moment before we conclude. I don't want to send you out on a party before we receive the offering or make the festivities available. I want to just talk to you for a moment. There are some of you in this place that you may not be in a position with God where we talked about in the when God would come and separate the sheep from the goats, one from the right to the left. And in the conclusion of Matthew, the 25th chapter, he talks about those who are not in the family of God, those who are not the children of God. And he says, you didn't clothe me, you didn't feed me, you didn't do this. And they said, when did we do this? You didn't do this. So I want to give you the opportunity tonight before we conclude, before we go any further in the service, I want to give you the opportunity tonight to ensure your place with God, to ensure your position with God Almighty. And I want to ask you this question. If you were to leave today and you were to die, heaven forbid that be the case, but your heart were to stop beating, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Such a simple question. Let's answer each one of that in our hearts. The Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. We ought to judge ourselves, to look into our own lives, to our own hearts. You know, you might say, well, you know, Pastor Luke, I'm not sure that heaven or hell is real. I'm not sure. I haven't really landed on that. The jury's still out. Listen, let me tell you something. Just because you haven't seen it, because you haven't felt it, because you haven't experienced it, doesn't mean that heaven's not a real place. Listen, you know that microwaves and radio waves exist because you experience them. You can hear the sound of my voice going from here to the sound booth, yet you don't see the waves that are carrying the signal of that. Heaven is a real place. Hell is a real place. Real enough for God to tell us about it, teach us about it, Jesus to teach us personally about it out of the Word of God. Real enough for us to take it serious. So come on, let's talk about this for a moment. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can think, want, or wish, like a positive outlook on life, that you're going to get into heaven? You can't get to heaven because you want to, because you hope so. You can't get to heaven because your parents told you you're a Christian. You can't get to heaven because you go to church, because you attend on Sunday or Sunday night, because you're here tonight. Because you're sitting in church tonight doesn't mean you're going to get into heaven. I love you enough to listen. I respect you enough to tell you the truth. It's not about what you and I do on the outside. It's not about whether or not we have got a cross or a St. Christopher around our neck. It's not about whether or not we do good things. Pastor Luke, I'm a good person. Good people go to heaven. Listen, the Bible tells us that our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. Nothing you and I could do on our own would ever make us good enough. It's not about volunteering in children's or youth. Simply put, it's God's heaven. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way. And Jesus is that way. Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. So today, let's not do this any other way but God's way. Jesus, in John, the third chapter, was talking to a man by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a good man. Nicodemus gave to the poor. He memorized the scripture. He taught in the synagogue, the church of his day. Nicodemus wore all the right clothes, said all the right things. And as they're discussing Jesus and Nicodemus, the subject of eternal life, you would think that Jesus says to Nicodemus, man, you just keep on going. But Jesus says to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, you must be born again. It's God's path to heaven right there. It's not what Hollywood makes it out to be. Not talking about that radical, weirdo, crazy, out-of-control Christianity. We're not talking about any of that. We're talking about God's definition. Here it is. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, born again has always meant this. Here it is. That you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all-or-nothing relationship with God. Let me prove it to you. First of all, the Bible tells us that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know who God is, know who Jesus is. They believe, the Bible tells us in the book of James, yet they're not on their way to heaven. It's not about your mental assent of who God is, not about your carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. Hey, I already know you know who Jesus is, that's why you're here. But God says it's an all or nothing relationship. Well, let me show it to you. In the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, Jesus is speaking to the church, and Jesus says he's coming back. And when he comes back, he better find us, the church, hot or cold, because if he finds us lukewarm, he will vomit us from his mouth. Wow. Shocking statement. And what Jesus is saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all and will be rejected, counted as waste from the kingdom of God, like we saw in Matthew the 25th, will be separated on the left side from the right. What does lukewarm mean? Let's define that. Lukewarm simply means a little bit in, a little bit out, a little occasional church attendance, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. Not wholehearted for God, not wholehearted against God. Listen, like this, we say it like this. You're riding the fence. One foot in, one foot out. Jesus says that that's you, that you're deceived in thinking that you're going to make it into the kingdom of God. And tonight I want to give you that opportunity. There's no other way. We can't do this your way. We can't do this my way or some well-meaning church committee's way. The only way you and I can get into God's heaven is God's way, and that's through Jesus. And Jesus said this also, that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. But if you deny him before men, he'll deny you before his Father. So in just a moment, I'm going to give you the opportunity. Here's what I'm going to do. On the count of three, I'm going to count to three. And on the count of three, I'm going to clap my hands together. I'm going to go like this. One, two, three. Smack my hands together real loud. And when I smack my hands, I want to give you the opportunity. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, hey, Pastor Luke, I want to make sure today, Pastor Luke, I want to give my heart to God. I want to give my heart to Jesus. I want to ensure my place with God in heaven. See, I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put your hand right back down right after that. You say, man, I might be embarrassed. You know what? You might be, yeah. But let me encourage you to shed that moment of embarrassment, because wouldn't it be better to be embarrassed for a moment than to spend an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God? The decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way, and it's your choice. He loves you enough to give you the free choice to choose him. God's not in the business of condemning men to hell. He's in the business of redeeming men to heaven. That's why the Bible says that he gave Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, so that we might have everlasting life. Not to condemn, but to redeem. God's in the business of redemption, but it's a free gift that you and I have got to choose for ourselves. So who should raise their hands? Maybe you've never done this in this place in the moment. If that's you, pop your hand up in just a moment. I'll see it. Who should do this? If you're not sure, hey, don't walk out of this place to that party without making sure where you stand with God today. This is your opportunity. This is your moment. Who should raise their hand if you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing? In just a moment, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. When I count to three, I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put your hand right back down. We'll go forward from there. We're going to pray. We're going to make it so easy for you today. We're going to pray with you right here in your seats. Couldn't be any easier than that today. The decision is totally and wholly yours, all over this place, all over this place. From the front to the back, family room, whether you guys back there, you hear the sound of my voice, if you're out in the back already trying to get some of that cotton candy, listen up. This is you. I'm talking to you right now. Wherever you're at, this is your time. This is your moment. God's not in heaven with a 2x4 waiting to smack you over the head. God says, I love you enough to give you this opportunity. Don't let this moment pass you by. This is your moment. This is your time. I'm going to count to three all across this auditorium. That's you. Get ready to get your hands up. This is your moment. This is the day of your salvation. Here we go. Get ready. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Get your hands up so I can see them. Eight wise people. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. All right. 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41. Where's your hands at? 42, 43. All right. I see this. 44, 45, 46. In the family rooms. In the family rooms. Anybody over there in the family rooms? How many of you got your hands? I got those guys in the back row. Family rooms. So I got your hand right over here, my man. I got you guys. How many in the family rooms? Four. 46. Four. Is that 50? I can count. I just got to take my shoes off. 50. All right. I see some hands over there. 50. I see that hand in the back. 51. 52. 53. All right. Well, hey, praise God. Hallelujah. Here's what we're going to do. If you prayed that, or if you raised your hand, or you didn't raise your hand, it's not too late. We're going to pray a prayer. The Bible says that if you believe with your heart, confess your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and raised from the dead, you shall be saved. So we're going to pray a prayer. It's not about an abracadabra magical formula. It's not anything about that. Simply put, it's about giving Jesus Christ your heart, making him the leader of your life, the Lord of your life. So we're going to pray. In just a moment, we're going to all bow our heads. But after service, as service follows the pillars, as you exit, we're going to have some SPT, some spiritual personal trainers. As you exit, right on each pillar, right here. Look to the, you know how airline pilots go like this? Find your nearest exit. Okay, see those two pillars? As you walk out, people with resources that we want to put in your hands. If you raise your hands tonight and you prayed this prayer, as you walk out, walk by and say, hey, I prayed this prayer for the first time, or I prayed this prayer tonight. Can I get what you have to give to me? They're going to pray. They want to pray for you if you need prayer. They want to hand that information to you, and then you can go on your way out to the party. We want to get some stuff in your hands so that you can walk and set your walk with God off on the right foot as you walk out of this place. So listen, why don't we do this? Let's all bow our heads and let's all prepare to go before the Lord. So let's, why don't everybody in this place, wherever you're at, everybody in this place, repeat this prayer after me. Father God, I come before you today and I acknowledge my need for a Savior. Lord, I acknowledge that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to live on this earth, to teach me your ways, to die on the cross for my sins, and to raise from the dead on the third day. I believe with all of my heart that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. I believe with all of my heart that Jesus is the Son of God. Lord, come and fill my heart today with your Holy Spirit. I repent of my old ways. Forgive me of my sins that I've committed, the ones that I don't even know about. I proclaim today, your word says, I am forgiven. I am saved. I am redeemed. I am a new creation. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I am a king's kid. In Jesus' mighty name, I am saved. Hallelujah. Amen. God is so good.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.